Hi, and welcome to part 3 of the Laptop GPU modding adventure. In the second video, you saw how I soldered some wires to the laptop's mainboard to communicate with the GPU via AM's I2C bus. I learned that the stock VRM temperatures are quite high and that I need to improve them before I can start to raise the power limit of the GPU with the shunt mod to 140W in total, instead of the stock 115W. The goal for this video is to modify the heatsink in a way the GPU VRM stay under 100 degrees centigrade, even after the 140W modification. I will attempt to create my own VRM cold plate and replace it with my stock one, which also means that I need to desolder the old cold plate and resolder my new one without destroying the heatsink. And destroying the heatsink is a real danger, since the heat pipes are very sensitive to excessive heat. They usually can withstand temperatures up to 200 degrees centigrade or even 250 degrees centigrade until they swell up and burst. To prevent their destruction, I need to pay close attention to the temperatures and raise the heat slowly in a controlled fashion. My first action was to take high resolution photos of the area the heatsink needs to fit in and find out about the dimensions of the most critical parts on the PCB and stock heatsink. Using these informations, I created a minimalistic CAD model to plan my own design. To get rid of the heat in the VRM power stages quicker, I needed to improve the thermal transfer. To do so, I need to reduce the distance between the cold plate and the power stages and inductors. In stock configuration, the heatsink uses 2mm thermal pads. To see significant improvements, I tried to redesign the new VRM cold plate to use just 1mm thermal pads. Using the sheet metal tool in Autodesk Fusion 360, I soon realized that I can reduce the gap to less than 1mm for the inductors easily, but wasn't able to produce a small enough band radius to come close enough to the VRM power stages than stock. The reason for is that I plan to use a 1mm copper sheet instead of the original 0.8mm one, and I got no proper sheet metal press to build up enough force to bend the sheet metal to a nice 90 degree stair-shaped cold plate as seen with the stock heatsink. So my only solution was to use a second layer of 1mm copper sheets to make the lower part 2mm thick in total and come closer to the VRM's power stage this way. I also increased the size of the lower part in a way I can cool down the closest ceramic capacitors with the heatsink too, with the goal to transport a little more heat away from that area in total. After finishing my sheet metal design, I created a press die in Fusion 360 and printed two iterations in PLA on my 3D printers. The plan was to use a bench vise to press both blocks together, which forced the copper sheet into the given shape. With some force and after two iterations, it turned out great. The curves are a bit less pronounced than planned in CAD, but the new cold plate is close enough to my reference 3D print and overall dimensions are fine. What was left were the little extension plates, which guarantee a less than 1mm gap to the VRM's power stages. I soldered them on with common SMD solder paste, which melts at the regular solder's 220 degrees centigrade. Desoldering the old VRM cold plate was not easy. At first I tried to do it with my cheap SMD hot air gun, but it got not enough power. Believe it or not, a copper heatsink got a lot of thermal mass and cools down quickly. What a surprise. I needed the help of an additional 2kW heat gun to get the job done. To prevent any unwanted damage to the heatsink, you basically need a temperature probe to make sure you are not overdoing things. What you really don't want is to desolder more things than just the spot you are working on. I mounted a temperature probe to the heat pipes and another one to the cold plate under a thick layer of Kapton tape. This way I can make sure I hover around the melting temperature on this exact spot and keep the other solder joints on the heatsink colder and solid. Heatsink components usually are soldered with low temperature solder, which melts between 137 and 140 degrees centigrade. As I reached 140 degrees centigrade, there were a lot of clicking noises, which indicated that the solid solder connection between the copper parts began to become loose. With gentle knocks on the cold plate, I tried to find out if all solder joints melted. At around 142 degrees centigrade on the heat pipes, the cold plate finally became loose. The resoldering was done with the help of very similar low-temperature soldering paste, which usually is used for heatsinks. Because there's not much wiggle room between the heatsink and the laptop's frame, I tried to align the new cold plate as precisely as possible. The resoldering process was much easier and quicker, because the thermal transfer between the cold plate and the heat pipes was much worse with the paste in between them than with the solid solder connection. As soon as I reached the melting temperature range, the temperature dropped off quickly, which I thought was the indication that the solder paste melted. After the heatsink cooled off, I saw that it melted indeed, and the resoldering was successful. So let's drop the heatsink in and find out if I achieved any improvements over the stock heatsink. As seen in part 2, we measured up to 95 degrees centigrade on the GPU Core VRM in Cyberpunk 2077 with the stock heatsink. Using the modified heatsink, I managed to drop the temperatures down to just 86 degrees centigrade. But I must note that I used other thermal pads than the stock ones. In the line plot, you can see a line recorded with 1mm Arctic thermal pads with 6 watts per meter Kelvin and with high-end 14 watts per meter Kelvin EC Gold ones. Looking at both lines, I should say that it makes no sense to pay the premium for the EC Gold thermal pads in this case. Interestingly, I also compared both thermal pads in a 2mm thickness with the stock heatsink, and it turns out that it does make a difference there. I'm not sure why the results are so close together with my modded heatsink though. I expected at least a very small difference, but maybe I'm already too close to the thermal transfer limits of the power stage I see, and I can't run them colder, since the VRM cold plate is connected to the heat output of the GPU and CPU anyway. Another interesting thing is that the VRM temperatures with the modded heatsink running time spy seem to drop when the fans kick in. All in all, the results are very good and should give me enough headroom to run the VRMs in a safe temperature range after I shunt mount the GPU to 140 watts. I hope I can operate them with less than 110 degrees centigrade or even 100 degrees centigrade to make sure the system can withstand the higher loads and could be operated at 140 watt TGP daily without any hiccups or shortfalls. Okay, we are coming to an end for this video, but the next one will finally show my attempt to increase the power limit of the GPU with the shunt mod. I will show you how it's done and what effect it got on our performance and, of course, the temperatures. After all modifications are working properly, I will finally sand down the heatsink's cold plates and send it to a company which will nickel plate the heatsink. Why nickel plating? Well, because I want to use liquid metal without any side effects. Sure, you can use liquid metal on bare copper, but it will kind of dry out over several months and need some reapplication over time. Using nickel as a diffusion layer, we can make sure the liquid metal will not react with the copper. Instead, it should stay where it is and would not require any maintenance for some years. Nickel plating is not necessary to use liquid metal, but it surely is the cleanest way to do it. Okay, nothing more to say then. Thanks for watching and see you in the next one. Bye!